In this lab, what we'd like you to do is use Processbook and Datalink, first of all, to search for PI unit batches and PI subbatches. Now, those are actually the unit batches and subbatches we created in the previous exercise. And we'll show both the current batches and the historical batches. We'll compare process values. And then we'll do this all the same type of thing using Excel. So we'll do that first in Processbook and then Excel. The first part of this exercise involves building a Processbook display. You're going to be building a display that shows the unit batches in either digester 1 or 2 and gives you the ability to search for each of them. We're going to be looking for specific types of unit batches, the ones that have completed in the last hour, the ones that are less than 10 minutes long. And then we'll take a look at the align options, which we'll see more later on. Also, in our second exercise, we're going to be looking at Datalink. Within Datalink, you're going to be building a report that's in Excel. Datalink is an add-in to Excel. It's going to take a look at the last unit batches. It's going to show key things about those unit batches, the start and end time of each unit batch, and then drill down into the little sub-batch elements within those unit batches. Here are what the two different solutions are going to look like. The Processbook solution is a display that has this BatchView object on it. This is the add-in to Processbook. It shows batch results. We've specified the name of the unit and specifics like the hour. We do a search and we come up with search results. And then depending on what we've chosen to display, we can show a Gantt chart and we can show trends of some of the aliases that you see here. Now the exercise on Datalink is going to look like this. It's a spreadsheet that's using the Datalink add-in, the BatchView add-in to Datalink, to retrieve batch records, and then also use the Datalink add-in to Excel to do calculations based on the PI tags that are aliased associated with that unit. So I can search for specific batches, like in this case it's digester 2, or I can switch to digester 1. I'm finding just those batches that match those. I'm finding the start and end time. And also by knowing what the unit is, and that's part of the batch record, we can then resolve an alias from the aliases listed here and the units listed right here. And that resolves into a PI tag. So as you can see, if I switch to pressure, different alias resolves into a different PI tag and we get a different set of numbers here. So what we have here is basically a nice little search engine for searching for batches and then producing some interesting statistics about the PI tags associated with those batch units. Now I'm going to start this exercise by closing out of my solutions here. And this is a copy of PI Processbook here. We'll start by opening this Processbook, this Processbook application up. It should be under Start Menu, All Programs, PI System. You should find PI Processbook. Now we're going to start and build a brand new display. File New. We'll do a Processbook PDI file. Now for the name, the exercise calls for the name Digesters. We'll press OK. It opens up this window. Now I'm going to maximize Processbook for the rest of this so that we can see a little bit better. I'm going to switch over into build mode. Currently I'm in run mode. I'll choose build mode. And I'm going to be adding this batch view object here. Now you also find that within the draw menu. There's an option there called batch group. So either way, I'm going to go ahead and click and draw open a batch group. It's going to be about as big as the current workspace there. Now once you do that, this dialog box appears. And this is where we're going to specify things like which batch unit we're going to be looking for. Now a previous exercise, if you did that before, you notice that we have something called unit batches and PI batches. We're going to be dealing with unit batches in this case. So we need to find the unit name that we're interested in searching for. This is the batch unit name that we're whose batch records we're trying to find. And unit is typically a piece of equipment where the batches run. Now do make sure that your server is selected properly. So this should be the server for the online learning labs. And then under unit name, what we're going to do is a straight string search. We're going to look for all the unit names to begin with the word digester. So digester should produce both digester 1 and digester 2. You notice the asterisk is used as a wildcard character. Now I'll go ahead and choose search, And what we should see is a series of batch records. Now, of course, if you turn this at home and you don't have any batches configured, you're not going to see anything. If that's the case, go back to the previous learning lab about building a simple batch, and this will give you some results that you can work with. But this is the list of resulting batch records. Now, if I were to switch this easily, just very simply from digester asterisk to put a 1 at the end of it, you'll notice that we limit our search results. So what we're talking about here is a very simple search mechanism that's using a string search to find specific units. I'm going to restrict this further. Instead of looking for everything, let's just go back 1 hour. These are fairly quick batches. They're only 4 or 5 minutes long, just to facilitate these in a learning lab environment. Now let me direct your attention down here to where we see available aliases. We're looking for all those aliases that are common among the different units. As you can see, there are different units, digester 1 and digester 2. And common to all of them are these two aliases. So I'm going to go ahead and add these. These are going to be the aliases we see in our trends. Now, if on your test system you're trying this and you don't see common aliases, it may be because the units that have been found don't contain common aliases, in which case you can just choose all, and then you'll find all the aliases available. Now, by default, this is only going to result in showing you a Gantt chart and a series of trends. I want to add the search results and the search mechanism. As you can see the preview here, that's the default behavior, Gantt chart plus trends, but we can add more. Now, if you take a look at your preview here, the search is showing, or the search results that we're seeing are showed previewed here, and you can configure those by either double-clicking right here on the preview itself, which you get in which case you get a configuration screen, or you can go up here where it says results and just click on configure. Either one gets you to the same place. And of course, this works the same for all of these. If I want to configure the Gantt chart, I can double-click here, or just double-click over here where it says Gantt, or just click on configure. What I'd like to configure in this instance, though, is the search. I'd like to add a couple of new search criteria, the duration and just a general filter. And as you can see in the preview, those will show up below. Now, another thing this exercise calls for is that this trend here is actually not just one trend, but multiple trends. And I can do that for each of these aliases by choosing the split option. You notice by choosing split, now we're going to see different trends, one for the one alias, one for the other. And as we've seen before, there's also a configure option for the trend. So if I choose configure, I can specify what type of, what name I'd like for this. For example, what trend title I want for this. So for example, in this case, this is going to be pressure. So we'll simply label it as such. I'll do that, and then do the same thing for temperature. And we'll call this temperature. So with all that configured, we're ready for the big finish, which is to take a look at our results. When you choose OK, now here's our search results. That's a little bit bigger, doesn't quite fit on my screen, so I can choose Fit All in order to make this fit a little bit better. And here are our search results. As you can see, we still have some things on here that we could probably improve on. For example, this is showing me this one long search, much, much longer than all the rest of them. So part of our next task would be to learn how to restrict this search results even further. Now, these are our first results, so let me demonstrate how to make edits if you don't like the way this is appearing. First of all, go into build mode. Now, when you initially select on that batch group, you'll get resizing handles that affect the entire batch group. So for example, I can click and drag, and this is going to affect everything within that batch group. As you can see, it just did. Now, I can also, after selecting once, I can double click to get the, I can select a second time, not double click, excuse me, to get access to the individual objects. So for example, this individual trend can be updated like just by clicking a second time after you've clicked on the batch group itself. I think I'm going to use this here to make this filter a little bit smaller. So if you notice, it's kind of large. I've selected my batch, and now I've selected my individual search. So I'll just pick that up, roll that up a little bit, pick this, and roll this down a little bit. And so now we're seeing something that looks a little bit better. It's not quite as good as I want it. So let me move this down some more. There we go. So now we have room to put our filter. We also have room to see our search results here. These are the results of this search. Now, these results should be explained here just briefly. These are the individual start and end times of each of these batches. As you can see, we have one of these batches here is fairly long. Most of these are about 3 minutes long. Now this one's about, this goes from 355 to 406. It's much longer than the others. If I look at the Gantt chart, I can see it's probably this one right here. That's unit batch ID 1192. And that is, in fact, yeah, that's the one it is, 1192. I can always remove that by just clicking on the little eyeglasses, and now it's no longer showing up here. So if you notice, we're automatically resizing what we display depending on what's been selected.